Amen. Well, let's give our God a round of applause. Our God, amen. 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 Well, too, I see some people in our crowd today who are walking through this season of cancer right now. And you know, but we're definitely praying for you guys and praying with you all. We have some who are online who we're praying for as well. We pray for the Rourke family as they are walking through this journey of cancer as well. We got some on the other end who are healing from cancer. So there are a variety of places and stations people are dealing with when it comes to cancer. Amen. So let's continue to be in prayer. Brother Clem is over here to my left right here. Let's be in prayer for him as well. And so we don't want to forget you all. We also want to be in prayer for you all who've lost loved ones to cancer and want to be sensitive to that on today as well. So let's continue to pray for all those, no matter where they are on this journey. Amen? Amen. Father, we do thank you and praise you, Lord, for your goodness, your grace, your mercy, your adequacy, your sufficiency. We now pray, God, that, Lord, you would speak to us, God. Lord, today is a day that you have made, and I want to pray, God, for those who are online, who are watching, God. I want to pray, God, for those who will see this video, Father. I want to pray, God, that, Lord, you would touch our hearts. No matter when we watch this, God, I pray that you would arrest our attention. I pray, Lord, that you would challenge us to be more Christian. I pray, God, that we can be, as the old folks say, sanctified. That, Lord, we can be set apart. And I pray, God, that we as believers in Jesus Christ, God, we do live distinctive lives that are set apart, God, from those who do not know you, Father. And God, our everlasting focus, God, is to become more like your Son, Jesus Christ. So in the midst of our society, our world, and our culture, Father, so often, God, we become confused about what the real mission is as Christians. And I want to pray, God, that we stay focused on who you are and what your mission is, personally and ministerially. It's in Jesus' name I pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen. Well, many of you all know that coming up right now are the midterm elections. How many of you all have a TV, a device that captures news? If you have a television, you have a device that captures news, then you know that what's happening right now are the midterm elections. You all see all the fighting, all the back and forth, all the advertising dollars. Everyone promoting their claim, people trying to fight for the House, people trying to fight for different positions in different places. And so there's a big fight that's going on right now. My goal today is to ask you one question. Are you going to be a courageous voter? Are you going to be a courageous voter? We're doing this series called Courageous and Contagious. And I want to see if you all are going to be courageous voters. So, Pastor, what do you mean? Are we going to be a courageous voter? I know who I'm going to vote for. I want to ask you all to reconsider who you vote for. Watch this now. I promise you all, I'm not going to tell you whom to vote for. Smile at me. Smile, because I know some of y'all kind of get kind of tight and wonder, boy, okay, now Pastor about to be a politician and tell us who to vote for, and I wonder who stuff to check inside of his pocket to come and tell him to tell us who to vote for. I'm not telling you who to vote for. The primary, listen to this, the primary issue for Christians is why and what we vote for more than who we vote for. The primary issue is why and what we vote for more than who we vote for. Unfortunately, we've come to a point to where it's become a personality-driven affair rather than a principle and a value-driven affair. We ought to ask first why, then who. Each of us will need to make a decision about whom we vote for, if and when we decide to vote. Smile at me. Y'all good? There are at least six reasons I think voting is more challenging today than it has been in the past. In a nutshell, I think there's political fatigue. We are tired of all the bickering and division. We are overwhelmed by the rhetoric. We are tired of all the personal attacks. If you agree, just say amen. We have difficulty for discerning the truth from lies. We have a limited discernible process, and then everything seems to be hopeless. We wonder if our vote even makes a difference. Amen? For clarity, my role and goal is not to tell you who to vote for, But I do want to influence why and what you vote for. Amen. You and the Holy Spirit will have to decide your vote. Do you have a decision-making principle when it comes to whom you're going to vote for? Now, here's the reality. Most of us walk into the voting booth wherever you go, in Tarrant County or counties beyond. You walk into the voting booth and you get this long list of people that you've never heard of before. Smile at me. You see a couple of names that are popular names, or you see a couple of people who are part of, quote unquote, the big, most popular vote. Then you see a bunch of names and precincts and bonds and proposals, but you have no idea who these people are, what they're about, what they're trying to vote for, what they support, what they don't support, what they believe, what they don't believe. And so many of you are, you know what, I'm going to go with the overall party and just vote for the entire party. And I want to suggest that's an ill-prepared voter. And I want to suggest, boy, that's not a courageous voter. Amen? Victory is not in who you vote for, but why you vote for them. Amen? I want to suggest that if you are part of any particular platform and you walk into the voting booth and you say, well, because I'm part of this platform and this person bears that label, I'm going to vote for them. I want to suggest that's not a biblical vote. It's not a conscious vote. It's not an intentional vote. And most of the time, it's not an informed vote. Amen? Amen? Amen. Now, I'm not telling y'all who to vote for, am I? Smile at me. Don't be throwing rocks at me. Pastor, trying to tell us who to vote for. I ain't trying to tell you who to vote. I want to encourage you on how to vote. I want to share with you all 7 habits of a courageous Christian voter. I want to share with you all 7 habits of a courageous Christian voter. Okay, guys, just cough. I mean, y'all ain't saying amen. Can you just cough? Can you just cough so I just know you're awake, you're here, everything is going all right, 7 habits of a courageous Christian voter. There are, I think, 3 formative passages when it comes to government, when it comes to voting. Y'all good? And I want to share this with you all before I jump off into these 7 habits. Number 1 is Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Can you all turn there in the sticky pages, page we don't get to very often, so it's still kind of sticking together. Isaiah 9, 6 says this, for to us a child is born, amen, to us a son is given, watch this now, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness. From this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The government shall rest upon his shoulders being that. This is a prophecy of Jesus Christ. Unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. That's the first. The second major passage is it's in the minor prophets, the book of Micah chapter 6, at verse 8. You all know this verse well. He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. You guys still good? Amen. These are 2 pivotal verses when it comes to our philosophy of government, our platform for voting, our view about voting. A third passage which weighs heavy on how we vote and government, and how we see government, is Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 7. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. For rules not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of those who is in authority? Then do what is good and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant. He is God's servant for your good. Amen. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. How many of you all have really done a biblical study on what it means to be a biblically informed voter? The reality is that many of us, when we go into the office, when we go into the booth to vote, we go in there with a man consciousness and not per se a God consciousness. So we go in with a man consciousness, but we're asking God to produce his results. Why do we ask God to produce his results when we don't function with his mindset? We don't function with his principles. We don't function with his values. We don't function with his convictions. We don't function with his vision, but then we're still asking God to give us his provision, give us his prosperity, give us his blessing, give us his best, and give us his will. And God said, if you want me to do all of that, then I want you to be conscious of who I am. Amen. Let me give you seven habits of a courageous Christian voter, and I'll take my seat. Number one, you've got to be clear on the role of government before you select those who govern you. You've got to be clear on the role of government before you select those who govern you. I think there are five parts to this biblical passage, Romans 13, verses 1 through 7. Number one, you see the premise of government in verse 4. Y'all good? In verse 4, he says this, 13:4, he says this, for he is God's servant for your good. In other words, watch this now. When it comes to government, government is not apart from God. Amen. Now, I know in our country, we think that government stands apart from God. Government stands alone from God. Around verse 1 and 2, it says that, boy, there is no authority that does not come from God. So government has no authority apart from God. Amen. Government is designed to be a minister and a servant of God. Amen. Are we tracking together? And so, well, Pastor, what about separation of church and state? That's not in the Bible. Because God does not want government separated from God. God says that government is supposed to be an expression. It's supposed to be a mediator. It's supposed to be a servant to God's will. So in verse 4, you see the premise of government. He says, for he is God's diakonos. He is God's servant for your good. God's government is designed for the good of all the people that he or she is governing. Amen. Not for some people, not for Democrats, not for Republicans, not for independents, not for the poor, not for the rich, not for the liberal, not for the conservative, not for the educated, not for the uneducated, not for those who live in the hood and those who don't live in the hood. The premise of government is that government is supposed to represent all the people that they govern. And we live here now in this divided states of America. Because we've got people who only represent segments of people and not all the people. And so watch this now. Do they view their role as sacred or secular? Anybody who is running for election, anybody who's going to be in government needs to understand that government is a tool of God and that now you are being used by God as a minister. And so the role that you are filling is not merely a secular role. It is a sacred role. Amen. Now, you may not wear a robe. You may not wear a collar. You may not carry a Bible, but you are a minister of God. Maybe other countries have it correct when they call the people who serve in government ministers. The minister of defense, the minister of education, the minister of so-and-so. Maybe if we put that nomenclature back in America, they would view their role as sacred and not merely secular. Then you see, second, the prominence of government. Verse 1, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. He doesn't write an exemption. Well, you know what? There are only some people who should submit themselves to government. Let every person be subject to the government, for there is no authority except for from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Amen. So what's interesting is that if your particular person doesn't become the president, your particular person or your particular party is not controlling Congress or controlling the House, do you still pray as fervently from them because they are instituted by God? So at the end of the election, no matter who ends up in office, the government is supposed to be instituted by God. And so you see the prominence of government. We are supposed to submit to government. The assumption is that government is submitted to God and that government is not trying to usurp God's authority. The reason we have so much chaos in our world and our government right now is because government is trying to usurp their authority over God rather than submitting themselves to God. And that's how we get ourselves in trouble, because we think that government is over God rather than God being over government. And we think that the government created the earth rather than the Lord is the creator of all the earth. Amen. So we see the premise of government. We see the prominence of government. Now we see the power of government. Look at verse 2. It says, therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. And those who resist will incur judgment. And so, you know, you don't have the authority to be anti-government when government is submitted to me. Number 4, you see the practice of government. Verses 3 through 5. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good and you will receive his approval. For he is God's diakonoi. He is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. The practice of government, the role of government is to celebrate what's good and to punish that which is evil. Amen. Let me ask you a question. Does that seem to be the modus operandi of our day in government? Does that seem to be the focus of government today? We look at government to protect our own personal interests rather than what God says, that you're supposed to look out for all people and distinguish between good and evil, celebrate good and punish evil. But then here's the price of government, verses 6 and 7. For the same reason, you also pay taxes. Say, Lord help us. Already. For the same reason, you also pay taxes. Now, he didn't say how much tax. He just say pay tax, right? We want to argue, well, Pastor, I'm tired of paying taxes, all right? He says, for the authorities are ministers, servants of God, attended to this very thing. So because the government is supposed to be ministers of God, God's plan is to fund government through taxes for everyone. Y'all good? Verse 7, pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. We see the premise of government, the prominence of government, the power of governance, the practice of government, and then the price of government. You've got to be clear of government. You've got to be clear on the role of government before you select those who govern you. Are you clear on the biblical role of government? I'm not asking if you have a view on the role of government. I'm asking, do you have a biblical view on the role of government? How many of y'all want your country to be better? Amen. Let me see your hands. Online, just raise your hand. Oh, boy, just put like on there or something, right? How many of y'all want to see your state be better? How many of y'all want to see our community? Well, boy, you got to make sure that you got people in office who are clear on their roles, and they view it spiritually and not merely as a secular role, merely as a career goal, merely as a way to climb up. Number 2, you got to be more focused on your spiritual election than your political election. Pastor, what in the world are you talking about? All righty. Ephesians 1 verse 3 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly. How many of you all know, as believers in Christ, you are already blessed? Amen. How many of you in Christ, the boy, you are already blessed? Some of us are trying to be blessed, go find blessing, pray for blessings. God says, as a believer in Jesus Christ, you are already blessed. And when you understand that you are already blessed, you wake up and you walk a different way. When you walk into a courtroom, you go in a different way. When you go into a boardroom, you go a different way, because you know you're already blessed. He says here, who has blessed us, past tense, in Christ, with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Watch this now, verse 4. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. Verse 5, he predestined us for adoption through Jesus Christ. This is election terminology. Amen. But we are more concerned about governmental election than we are about God's election. But when you walk into the voting booth, you have to understand that, boy, you walk in for an election, but you are already the elect. You are chosen by God. God has chosen you. God wants to use you. God wants to see you be a preserving factor here in our world. And you cannot do that unless you represent him. You know, I think that we're more concerned about our representatives than we are about representing God. We are more concerned about our representatives than we are about our role as representatives of God. How many of y'all are going to rep for God in this election? How many of y'all going to rep for God when you go to work? How many of y'all going to rep for God when you're in the community? How many of y'all going to rep for God when you go speak? How many of y'all going to rep for God in how you carry yourself? We are representatives of God. Matthew 5:16 says, let your light so shine before men. They see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. God wants us to be living billboards for who he is. And so when you go into the voting room, you are there to represent God, not merely trying to find somebody to represent. Represent you. And so he says, watch this now. You need to make sure that you're more focused on your election, your spiritual election, than you are about a political election. There's a book out by a guy named, what's his name? Sider is his last name, S-I-D-E-R. And he talks about good news and good works, the title of his book. He includes 10 questions that are critical for determining a church's position when it comes to social action. So watch this now. People, but let's be activists. Let's change the world. Let's transform the world. And boy, I think it was Einstein that said, and boy, Obama repeated, you cannot solve a problem on the same level it was created. But then we're so busy trying to solve political problems on a political level, we're trying to solve problems on the same level they were created. And so when it comes to social action, the question becomes not just do you do social action, but what is the church's, what is the Christian's biblical worldview when it comes to social action? Amen. And so, boy, here's part of the problem. Many people jump into action but ain't got no substance behind their action. They jump into action but have no idea where they're going. They jump into action because the crowd is loud, the crowd is moving, the crowd is upset, but they've got no substantive solutions and interventions and measurements for what they're looking for. Are we tracking together? So when you I want to see social action, I want to see justice. Okay, then give me 10 illustrations of what that justice looks like. I want to see justice. Okay, tell me what that justice. Well, I just want justice. Well, if you cannot define justice, how are you going to validate and judge and determine if justice has been administered or not if you've got no standard for justice? Amen. Are we tracking together? And so I share with you guys the last time somebody got shot, a white cop shot a black guy, or somebody was martyred. I say, guys, everybody's up in arms right now, but in 6 months, we won't even hear about this anymore. When was the last time we heard about the guy who was shot over in Dallas? And when was the last time you seen somebody marching? When was the last time? So anyway, we got to get this stuff straight. You want to know why? Because we had no strategy. And without a strategy, there is no transformation. But then we come back when the next person gets shot. When the next person, well, we up in arms again and we screaming and we shouting and we yelling. But we still got no substantive position on how we want to change things. And the problem is this, we are electing people who promise things, but we never go check their record to date. And then as they've been in the office, we don't check to see if they follow through on what they promised. Then we go and reelect them without validating on whether they are truth sayer or were they just talking stuff. We never go and validate, did they do what they said they were going to do? So here are 10 questions he proposes for a church's view or platform. Number one is, how shall we understand sin? When the last time you heard these ministers talking about sin? Not the ones in the pulpit, but the ones who's on the platform. When was the last time they talked about sin? How shall we understand people? Number three, what is the gospel? Number four, what is salvation? Number five, what's the connection between our work now for justice and freedom and perfection of the coming kingdom that comes only at Christ's return? How many of y'all know that God's goal is not to refurbish earth so you can live here forever? God is not into a re-gentrification program. He's going to wait till all the neighborhoods die out, come in, buy low, rebuild, and sell high. That is not God's kingdom plan. God's kingdom plan is that God wants to redeem people. 2 Peter chapter 3, this earth shall melt with fervent heat. Revelation 21 and 22, he's going to create a new heaven and a new earth for the new bodies he gives new believers. Amen? When you go vote, is that in mind? When you go vote, do you have God's position, God's agenda, God's worldview? And number six, what is the ultimate source and authority for answering such tough questions? See, most of us are more concerned about education than we are revelation. But y'all know I'm real into education. I mean, I'm real in education, right? But watch this now. Education will never trump my revelation. And revelation is the word of God. Education will never trump what the Lord has to say. Y'all good? I thought it was going to be a quick sermon. Number seven, who or what is the object of evangelism? Number eight, how is the gospel shared? Number nine, how is or not has society changed? And where is the primary location of God's activity today? First habit is you got to be clear on the role of government before you select those who govern you. Number two, you got to be more focused on your spiritual election than your political election. Number three, you have to prioritize God's platform over a man-derived platform. Oh, ain't no amens to that. Sister Womack, did you bring the amens with you this morning already? Because they struggling up in here this morning. I know I'm preaching the word of God. Watch this now. You got to prioritize God's online. You got to prioritize God's platform over a man-derived platform. I want y'all to be clear. I'm not preaching Republican. I'm not preaching Democrat. I'm not preaching independent. I'm preaching Jesus Christ who died for our sins. I'm preaching God's word that has once been delivered unto the saints. I'm preaching an eternal revelation, and boy, heaven and earth shall pass away, but his word, hallelujah. And maybe we ought to hear more about God and God's word these days to transform society. And so if you go and say, you know, but well, I'm part of this platform, and because I'm part of this platform, then boy, I got to go with the party, but I got to go with the platform. No matter what the candidate says, I've got to go with the platform. But let me ask you a question. Is the platform perfect? And so how do you consistently follow a platform that was derived by man that is flawed at best? So whenever you commit yourself to a platform, you've committed yourself to imperfection. You've committed yourself to inconsistency, and you have committed yourself to something that is flawed. Amen. Commit yourself to God. Commit yourself to the word of God. And so every election, every person, you ask, are they sacred? Are they secular? How do they view God? How do they represent God? Do they share God's values? Or are they carrying their own values? You know, it's interesting. Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, these guys were philosophers that really influenced our world. And so when you read Nicomachean Ethics by Aristotle, you'll see a lot of what we do and what we value in culture and our world and our society today. Aristotle put pen to and kind of crafted. And but those become kind of our aspirations. And so then there's a guy by the name of Augustine that came along in the 4th century. Augustine comes and says, no, but we got to get God in this picture. Because, boy, this picture ain't got God. And so, boy, it's looking for good, but it does not have God. And how many of us are just looking for good, but not per se looking for God? Maybe our culture's in trouble because, boy, we're so busy trying to elect people for our own personal good that we have forgotten to look for God. Amen. Then another guy came along by name Thomas Aquinas. Aquinas came along and, boy, Aquinas tried to synthesize what Aristotle had said. Put together what Augustine had said. And so he had these things called cardinal virtues or cardinal values. But then he also added spiritual or theological virtues. Theological were faith, hope, and love. How many of you all know that, boy, it's just not a matter of having virtues, having the right virtues. And so, boy, we want people who are virtuous, but the question becomes, what is the content of their virtue? And many of us don't look for virtue in our candidates anymore. Amen. And so, boy, when you follow a platform, you've already committed yourself to imperfection. James Sire, in his book, Good News and Good Deeds, he talks about four different positions we can have towards social action. And what churches often have. You know what? You've got those who focus solely on personal salvation with no consciousness about social and political. On the other extreme, then, well, you got churches who are just so focused on the social, they've forgotten about the spiritual and the eternal. Two mediating positions, but you got people who focus on a lot on personal salvation and a little bit on social and political. Then you got those who focus a bunch on the social and political, but just a little bit on personal salvation. He said, well, Pastor, where in the world should we fall? I'm going to talk about that some on our Wednesday nights coming up. Smile at me. You got to prioritize God's platform over a man-derived political platform. Number four, you got to prioritize why you vote for a candidate over who you vote for as your candidate. You've got to prioritize, why are you voting for this candidate? Well, he went to Yale. He went to Harvard. He went to the best. Well, boy, those schools are not known for following God anymore. Amen. They were initially started, Yale and Harvard, those schools were initially started to propagate the gospel and the Bible of Jesus Christ. Now, when you go to those campuses, the Bible is not elevated. The gospel of Jesus Christ is not celebrated. Following Christ as Lord is no longer considered to be intellectually valid and sensible because they veered away from following God. So I could care less if they went to Yale. I could care less, not because I want them to be stupid. I want to know, what are their values? What is their substance? Do they follow God? Do they believe in the word of God? Do they view their role as sacred? Where do they stand on abortion? Where do they stand on homosexuality? Where do they stand on sexual assault? Where do they stand on lying? Where do they stand on cheating? Where do they stand on education? Where do they stand on caring for the poor? Where do they stand on artificial reproductive technology? Do they stand where God stands, or do they stand away from where God stands? Are we tracking together? And if you can't roll through those issues fluently, you ain't ready to vote. You haven't done your homework. Amen. You become influenced by the propaganda. You become influenced by the rhetoric. You got to prioritize the why you vote for a candidate over who you vote for as a candidate. Number five, you got to vote for the glory of God. Amen. Over the glory of man. Y'all good? Amen. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, what does it say? What's it? Verse 23 says this: all things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful, but not all things build up. Verse 24, let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. Government's supposed to be interested in not just a certain segment of people, not a certain tribe of people, but all people. Are we tracking together? All things, but not all things build up. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. Let me ask you a question. Are the Republicans and the Democrats, who primarily control Congress and a couple independents, are they looking out for the good of their neighbor, or are they just looking out for the good of their neighborhood? I thought you all were there to represent all the people, not just a certain segment of people. The Bible says a house divided against itself cannot stand. What is the destiny of destiny of America? Well, boy, we've got a divided Congress and we cannot come together. How in the world are we trying to fight for democracy in other countries that we can't be unified in our own country? Man, we ought to spend billions of dollars. How can we get along? Rather than trying to tell somebody else how to get along, and we are divided. We can barely sit together, stand together, talk together, walk together, eat lunch together, but we're going to try and tell another country how to get their life together. I'm preaching up in here. You ain't even got to say amen. Preaching the word of God. Verse 31, so whatever you eat or drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Amen. Do all to the glory. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God. Just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, that they may be saved. How many of us view life through, you know what, I want to see people get saved. I want to see people who serve. Used to be an old song, who's on the Lord's side? You got to vote for the glory of God over the glory of man. Next, you got to focus more on discernment than division. Y'all good? I know y'all want just some hype right now. You know, Pastor, just come hype us up for the vote and tell us to go vote for somebody who and Pastor, for y'all that stuff. Watch now. We got to focus more on discernment or with discernment rather than division. Y'all good? 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Y'all want to learn something today? Okay, I'm going to show y'all this real quick, but I'm going to let y'all go. That clock is demonic. It's divisive. It's got its own platform. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 6. Yet among you the mature, we do impart wisdom. Although it's not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are doomed to pass away. Amen. So Paul's here talking about different types of wisdom. Talk about how the Christ is the wisdom and power of God. Then he comes here and he says, you know, Greeks seek after a sign, the Jews, to the Jews, the cross is a stumbling block. See, we speak to you all as mature, but we impart wisdom. Watch this now. The wisdom we impart is not the wisdom of the world. Why are we trying to get non-believers to understand the wisdom of God? Non-believers will never concur and agree with the wisdom of God unless the Holy Spirit is working in their life to bring them to Christ, so now they change their capacity to understand the things of God. Amen. Are we tracking together? Verse 7, but we impart a secret and hidden wisdom of God, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Watch this now. Y'all love this verse. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart has imagined, what God has prepared for those who love him. And this verse tears up some Baptist churches. You hear me? Let me tell you the King James Version. I have not seen, neither ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man. What God has in store. Now, boy, I'm telling you, if I could do it, I would do it. I ain't mocking it. If I could do it, I would do it. I would do it, right? All right. Wait till I get my new voice in heaven. And boy, I get some revving. Boy, I'm gonna be going. I'm preaching the 3 o'clock hour in heaven. What I have seen. Look at him walking down the Via Della Rosa. Look at him dying. Okay, let me throw him in the rock. All right. Watch this now. What I have not seen, nor ear heard, nor entered the heart of man, what God has in store for those who love him. But look at verse 10. These things, what are these things? What I have not seen, nor ear has not heard, what man has not imagined. Watch it now. These things God has revealed to us. Who are us? Us, our believers. How has he revealed them? He has revealed them through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For who knows a person's thoughts except the spirit of the person which is in him? Stop saying you know somebody's heart. You don't know nobody's heart. Only the Spirit knows somebody's heart. You may see somebody's actions. You may see their pattern. You may, but boy, you don't know what's going on. So boy, stop trying to be the person that knows. Well, I know what your, you don't know. You better know what your heart doing. You don't know where your heart at. How are you going to know where my heart is? Stop talking. Let God be the heart fixer and the mind regulator. So also, no one comprehends the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. We understand the thoughts of God because the Spirit of God reveals to us the wisdom of God. Verse 12. Now we have not received the Now we have received not the spirit of the world. The world is that system that's set up against God. It's not talking about this physical cosmos, but the Spirit who was from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. The Spirit helps us understand the things that are freely given to us by God. How many of you all have passed up on a free lunch? And we impart this in words, watch this now, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. See, the problem is society does not acknowledge or appreciate the work of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Society and culture does not value and appreciate the things of God. Society is trying to get you to stop being so stupid and stop being such a doofus and believing in something you cannot see and you cannot touch. And we say, you know what? I know he's real, but I ain't never seen him. I've never touched him, but I feel him every day. Granny said he runs from heart to heart and breast to breast. He woke me up this morning. He started me on my way. I share love you, boy. When you experience God, there's no greater experience than God. And there's nothing more difficult than trying to tell a person that's never experienced God what the experience of God is like. So they try selling you on naturalism. They try selling you on secular humanism. They try selling you on relativism. And all these other isms that Colossians chapter 2 talk about. But God wants to say, you know what? I want to teach you spiritual wisdom. Verse 14, the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly to him. He's not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. For who has understood the mind of the Lord as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. When you go into that voting booth, are you functioning with the mind of man, or are you functioning with the mind of Christ? Amen. Are you functioning with the priorities of man, or are you functioning with the priorities of God? We've got to get over the self-interest thing. When you go into the voting booth, you can't just go in there and say, you know what, what's good for me? You have to say, what's good for humanity? Your automatic thinking, you know what? You know what, boy? It's a utilitarian perspective. You know what? All is well that ends well. The ends justify the means. Whatever works out best for me is good, no matter how it impacts other people. I may have an abundance. If somebody ain't got nothing, we're just going to call it socialism, and then we're going to crucify. So you know what? I am not my brother's keeper. Amen. The Bible says I'm my brother's keeper. That's more detail than what we can get into. You got to focus more on discernment. Number seven, say amen. Amen. You got to ensure Christianity. Listen to me now. You got to ensure Christianity is modifying instead of being modified. Let me say it slower. You got to ensure Christianity is modifying and not being modified. Amen. See, boy, we're in today. Well, you know what? The word can't mean that. Let me modify it. The definition of marriage can't mean that. Let me modify it. The definition of adultery can't mean that. So let me modify it. The definition of sin can't mean that. So let me modify it. God says, stop allowing everything else to modify Christianity. Christianity ought to be modifying everything else. So instead of trying to change Christianity, Christianity and Christ ought to be transforming everything else. Christianity ought to be transforming the individual. Christianity ought to be transforming addiction. Christianity ought to be transforming sin. Christianity ought to be transforming education. Christianity ought to be transforming financial policy. Christianity ought to be transforming how we view stem cell research. Christianity ought to be transforming our financial markets. The financial market shouldn't be transforming Christianity. Government should not be transforming Christianity. Government and the world should not be transforming what marriage means. How in the world are you going to redefine what you didn't come up with? Amen. The earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell there. What gives you the authority to change what God has put in place? Amen. Wonder why we got chaos. Because we're allowing things to modify Christianity. Rather than Christianity modifying other stuff. Y'all good? I done put something on your mind today. Romans chapter 12. Cowboys, come on at noon. I got to get you home. We need Jesus again. The boy Rush wasn't rushing too well last week, was he? Verse 1, I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not be modified by this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Richard Niebuhr talks about, he wrote a book, Christ and Culture. He identified five different positions that boy Christ may have toward culture. He's got three primary and then some subsidiary ones under the third one. It's Christ against culture. It's Christ of culture. It's Christ over culture. I suggest our view ought to be Christ over culture. And Christ wants to be a conversionist. Christ wants us to save people from a dying world. Christ wants us to live for him, glorify him. Here's my question. Will you be a Christian, courageous voter this election? Daryl Bach, New Testament scholar from Dallas Theological Seminary, gives us three questions to consider as we prepare to vote. Number one, what values determine what our government and society should strive to be? What values determine what our government and society should strive to be? Number two, how much should I be willing to sacrifice for the betterment of the whole? Or am I just interested in what's good for me? Number three, if government does not take up this human concern, then where and how will it be addressed? And does the alternative have a real chance of doing it better and in a more efficient way? Churches foolishly say, we're going to meet the needs of all humanity. And that God's goal is for the church to take care of everybody that's hungry, everybody that's in need, everybody need a house. I heard T.D. Jakes say, I don't quote these all the time, but I heard him say this. He said, if the government can't do it when they take 28% off the top, how are we going to do it when we get 10% off the bottom? People in church don't give. For the most part, smile at me. They think God just send down money and put it inside the church's bank. You know what? It's like manna from heaven. They just land the bank and they ask about buildings. People keep asking, well, Pastor, when we going to build the building? I say, have you seen the giving lately? And I ain't complaining. I'm just saying. Let's be honest about it. Most churches, they're less than 10% of people, no matter what their denomination, no matter what their color is, they're less than 10 people who give at least 10% of their income. Amen. And we talk about funding the world's poverty crisis. We can't solve our own church poverty crisis. How are we going to solve the world's poverty crisis? Amen? Amen. And so God wants to use government as his minister, as his servant. I want you to have a different view on government. Biblical values, this is what Bach says, biblical values do not address what the structure of government ought to be. But they do consistently raise value questions about how I care for and love my neighbor. The tension in this topic is how do we best get there? It tells that politics may not be as much about opposing views as it is about balancing tensions that need alignment. This is my statement. We need to ensure that we are voting based on Christian values instead of non-Christian values. All values are not equal. You can make the deciding vote. Father, we come to you today, Father, and God, this is probably a little bit more deep than what we anticipated. And it's probably challenging our perspective of voting. We thought it was just go in and pull the lever, the old school lever. But the person who best represented my personal interest. But I want to pray, God, we go back and reevaluate how we vote and why we vote, as opposed to just who we vote for. It's in Jesus' name, I ask it all. Amen. Amen. And God bless you.